So, first of all, you are the founding member of the Pakti.
You are one of the founding members.
It's a Palestinian campaign for the academic and cultural boycott of Israel. And if you could please tell us what the organization's activities consist exactly, what is your purpose?
In general, Pakti, the Palestinian campaign for the academic and cultural boycott of Israel, was launched in 2004. And we started with launching a call for boycott of Israeli academic and cultural institutions due to their complicity in Israel's ongoing occupation, apartheid, and colonization, denial of Palestinian rights. So from the start, ACBI focused on international organizations, academic and cultural, international academics, individuals as well, calling on them to boycott Israeli institutions. It's very important to explain that the boycott does not target individual Israeli academics or cultural figures, but rather institutions. We focus on the institutional complicity of the Israeli academy and cultural establishment in perpetuating occupation and apartheid. And there are many, many examples for this.
What is the organization hoping to achieve by the boycott, both in the short term and the long term?
Our main goal is to weaken and ultimately end Israel's denial of Palestinian rights, basically its occupation, its apartheid inside Israel against its so-called non-Jewish citizens, the indigenous Palestinians, and the right of return for the refugees. These are the three basic rights that we focus on and we ultimately hope to achieve. How to achieve this? Through boycotting the academy and cultural establishments. Every bit helps. The academy in Israel is one of the main partners, one of the main pillars of the system of oppression. Weakening that complicity, weakening that link, weakens the entire project of oppression, the multi-tiered system of oppression against the Palestinians.
So could you tell us a little bit more in specific in which way the academic institution of Israel are complicit or contributing to the occupation?
Yes, academic and cultural, of course, but academic is the clearer case. The academy in Israel, the universities, have from the start, from the Nakba, the 1948 ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians, played a role in planning, in justifying, in promoting, and in whitewashing Israel's crimes against the Palestinian people. Until now, the Israeli academy is playing a role in denying the Nakba. There's complete Nakba denial. And they portray the history of Israel as if it were liberated from British occupation. So they completely obliterate the history of settler colonialism, the taking over of Palestine and the expulsion of the majority of the Palestinian people, dispossessing them and destroying more than 500 villages, Palestinian villages, to prevent the return of refugees. The Israeli Academy is the main party in Israel responsible for perpetuating and propagating this myth about how Israel was created as a state until now. Beyond that, every aspect of Israel's oppression against the Palestinians had a contribution from the academy as well, from building colonies, the settlements in the occupied West Bank, including Jerusalem, as well as Gaza in the past, building the colonies, the occupation system itself, the weapons systems that are used to commit war crimes against the Palestinians, as happened in the Israeli massacre in Gaza end of 2008, early 2009. And I'll just give one example. The UN, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty, the entire world condemned Israel for committing using disproportionate force against the Palestinians in Gaza, as if this were a secret. Israel has announced that it's using one of the army doctrines used by the Israeli military. It's called doctrine of disproportionate force. That's what they call it. And this doctrine was developed through workshops between the military, the military industry, and the academy at Tel Aviv University. Through many workshops, this concept, this doctrine was developed, and basically it says that since Israel cannot effectively combat irregular resistance forces, such as Hezbollah, to a lesser degree Hamas, the most effective way is to target the civilian infrastructure, and to make the civilians hurt so much that they will do Israel's bidding and pressure the resistance to stop resisting.
Yes.
So this very evil, very criminal law, doctrine that violates international humanitarian law very clearly, so it's a war crime, was developed at Tel Aviv University. Another very big example is Israeli colleges and universities built on occupied Palestinian territory, so acting as colony colleges, such as Ariel, which is built on the lands of Salfit near Nablus, such as Hebrew University. One of its campuses is built on occupied East Jerusalem. It is occupied Palestinian territory. And this is ignored by the world community when they discuss the Israeli Academy, as if the Israeli Academy were liberal or progressive. The fact is, it's not. It's very much a partner in crime.
Awesome. Now, we understand the purpose and appreciate the success in other forms of boycott, as for example with the Veolia, French company that formerly was contracting the illegal Jerusalem light rail system, and after significant economic losses due to the BDS boycott, they had to renounce to the contract. But it has been argued that ideas and knowledge should be treated differently than tangible commodities, and that an academic boycott, in contrast to economic, trade or political boycott, will not even be noticed by the government. Change is much more likely to occur by providing information than by withholding it. Mm. Do you have anything to say?
Yeah, there are many mistakes in this long paragraph that you read. First, Veolia did not withdraw. It announced its intention to withdraw, but it couldn't, because it's bound by the contract, legal contract with the State of Israel, and it made it very difficult for it to withdraw. Yes, it lost billions of dollars, mainly due to the BDS campaign against it, plus other issues, but it could not withdraw until now. Until now, Veolia, as well as Alstom, are involved in the Jerusalem Light Rail, which is an illegal project according to international law. As far as the academic boycott, there's a complete misunderstanding what academic boycott means. It does not ban ideas or thoughts. It does not ban communication. It does not ban any exchange of ideas. This is just a myth. It's a complete misconception about academic boycott. The academic boycott targets academic institutions. It says that any university in Italy, La Sapienza, for example, should not be in bed with Tel Aviv University, Hebrew University, and Ben-Gurion University, because it helps whitewash their crime, their complicity in crime, by doing those institutional links. Nothing in the academic boycott prevents Israeli academics from traveling, participating in conferences, publishing, exchanging ideas. There's absolutely nothing in the PACB academic boycott that would prevent academics from continuing academic life. Of course, once funding and institutional links are weakened with the world, this will affect the university, which will affect academics, and so be it. That's the minimal price they should pay for their complicity. We are not shy about this. And why is this only brought up in the case of Israel and was not brought up in the case of South Africa? Very few had a problem with the concept of a full academic boycott of South Africa. In fact, in South Africa, it was a blanket boycott against individuals as well as institutions, unlike the Palestinian boycott, which is only institutional. In South Africa, it was a boycott against every single individual academic. And there was a list. If you're on the list, you cannot go and participate in conferences. In the Palestinian case, until the UN develops such lists, we are not interested in blacklisting. We're not interested at all. In principle, we are against any form of blacklisting, any form of McCarthyism. So we don't want to judge who's a good Israeli academic, who's a bad Israeli academic. We don't get into this business. We judge an institution based on institutional links, the structure of oppression, and the academy's role in that structure of oppression. That's what we're targeting, not the individual academics.
Nevertheless, Palestinian students and Palestinian academics are barred from collaborating with either students or academics in Israel, am I correct?
Barred is not a very accurate term. The academic boycott calls on Palestinians. We don't bar. We don't have the authority to bar. We're a moral campaign. The only form of pressure we apply is moral pressure. We issue statements, and we send letters, and we engage institutions and individuals trying to convince them. If they're not convinced, we don't do anything else. We don't have the power, neither the will or the desire to ban anything. So it's very important to be very accurate with the terms used. Yes, the academic boycott calls upon Palestinian academics not to cooperate at all with any form of Israeli university institution. Also, the Council for Higher Education, the Palestinian Council for Higher Education, which is part of the Ministry of Education, oversees higher education in the occupied Palestinian territory, has since the 90s called for a boycott of the Israeli Academy. This is not new. It has continuously called for it, and that council has all the heads of universities as well as the Ministry of Education. So it said that until the occupation ends, Palestinian universities should not cooperate. As at the individual academic level, Palestinian academics cooperating with Israeli academics, in order for this to be helpful for the Palestinian struggle, there are two conditions that need to be met, according to the boycott campaign. The first condition is that the Israeli side has to recognize Palestinian rights under international law. You cannot say, oh, I want to end this but keep that form of oppression just because I like it. Either we have to be completely consistent and we say international law applies in this case as in any other case. Either we respect universal human rights and international law or we don't. There's nothing in between. You say, I respect some rights but not others because Palestinians are not fully human. This is a racist position that we cannot accept. Either we accept that all international law applies, universal human rights apply, or we don't. So, having said that, the condition is that the Israeli party involved in any joint Palestinian-Israeli academic or cultural project has to recognize Palestinian rights under international law and oppose Israel's system of oppression. Second condition is that the project itself has to be a form of resistance against that oppression. What do I mean by that? It doesn't mean direct resistance. Academics don't go on the street and demonstrate only, or throw stones necessarily. They have other means of resisting. An example is Ilan Pape, for example, the famous Israeli historian. He published a book about the ethnic cleansing of Palestine, exposing the Zionist myth about independence from British occupation. He exposed what was done to create Israel, the massive ethnic cleansing and dispossession. This is a form of resistance. If a Palestinian historian had cooperated with Ilan Pape and co-authored that book, that's not considered normalization. That's considered a form of resistance. The first condition is met. Ilan Pape does recognize Palestinian rights. And the second condition is met. The project itself is a form of resistance. So archaeologists, sociologists, academics of all types, architects, dancers, musicians can have joint projects that are explicitly geared towards resisting the oppression. Why is the second condition important? Why isn't just the first condition that the Israelis have to recognize Palestinian rights? Second condition is important in order not to give a false impression of normalcy. When an oppressor and oppressed are together in a project, they cannot deceive the world. They should not deceive the world and make it appear as if life is normal. You know, women and women on both sides discussing feminist issues and working together on feminist projects. That's normalization. This is deception. It gives a false impression of symmetry. It gives a false impression of coexistence despite oppression. And we're not interested in that. We want to be honest. And we want to give a transparent view of what's happening. We are under occupation and apartheid. Any relationship has to be governed by that or to resist that. You can't be neutral in situations of oppression. If you're neutral, you're siding with the oppressor. So any project that claims to be neutral, above politics, whatever other terms they use, is by necessity indirectly helping the perpetuation of oppression because it's not taking a position. In South Africa it was the same, in Germany it was the same, in any other context it was the same. Only when it comes to Israel is the issue raised. Why can't people have normal human relations? Of course they should, once oppression ends. Until that happens, every relationship has to be directed towards ending oppression, not establishing normal relations, which are abnormal by definition.
Yeah, looking at the whole matter from a science perspective, looking the whole matter from the science perspective, there is who wants to opposite these boycott parties. Often argued that the universality of science, this principle of the universality of science.
Oh, universality, okay.
Yeah. Is that the contact between scientists in different countries can act as a powerful force against xenophobic and nationalism.
Okay.
What would you say about that?
I mean, what would we say about German scientists in the 30s?
Yeah.
The exact same.